The light of the world is Jesus. 391. All right. Let's give it our best this morning. The whole world was lost in the darkness of sin. The light of the world is Jesus. Like sunshine at noonday, his glory shone in. Of the man that was born blind. And the verse that we just sang, go wash at his bidding and light will arise. The light of the world is Jesus. Once I was blind, that's all a part of that account. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. Do you believe it this morning? I certainly do. The light of the world is Jesus. When we come to the refrain, instruments drop out, let's sing of the light. On the last, no need of the sunlight in heaven, we're told. The light of the world is Jesus. Father, I stand here today so grateful that in darkness we have light. And I'm thankful that the light of the world is Jesus. Oh Lord, would you let that permeate our thoughts and minds today as we worship? I pray that you'll take our minds from anything that'll distract us from worshiping you, singing, praying, and preaching. Arrest our hearts and our attention. And Lord, I pray that our hearts would be slain before your feet as we hear your word. I pray for any that are lost, God, that you'd help them to understand they can be found any blind that they'll see that they can see today. And Lord, I just ask for your richest blessing upon the service. In Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. "801 will be our next song. That's "How Great Thou Art." 801. Let's think about this song. Is God good to you today?
Amen.
Amen. Amen for those three people that realize it's God's goodness, but I'm going to talk to the rest of us now. Has God been good to you today?
Amen.
Regardless of what you think, he allowed you to be here. He allowed you to wake up to see another day and gave you the health and strength to complain about the things you don't have, right? Hopefully that's not the case. 801. How great thou art. How great thou art. 801. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, out lively this morning. Went through the wood and forest glades I wander, and hear the bird sing sweetly in the tree. And when I look from lofty mountain grandeur, good, let's sing it out this morning. My soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Amen. Good singing.
Glad to be in the Lord's house today, and we're glad to have you here with us today. And if you are a guest, a visitor, and this is your first time at Cornerstone Baptist Church, we're not going to embarrass you. You don't have to say or do anything, but we do have a visitor's card for you as well as a small gift from Cornerstone Baptist Church. And so if you are a first-time visitor, if you would slip your hand up as the ushers file through, they'll give you a visitor's card as well as a pen to fill it out with. You can take that card, open it up, tear it in half, keep the side with the picture and the order of services, and then put the other section in the offering plate when it comes by in just a moment. Again, glad to have everyone here, especially if you are a visitor. I want you to be praying this week, and I want to have some special prayer today and Wednesday night for next Sunday, which is our friend day. And I want you to remember the exhortation to not come alone next week, to make sure you bring at least one visitor. If everybody does that, then we'll have, I'm sure, a good group of unsaved people for Pastor Carl Lubin to preach the gospel to. And then the second thing I'm going to ask you to do is sign up for the potluck meal that we're having. There's a sign-up sheet posted, and we want you to bring whatever you can to help feed the folks that are coming as far as our guests. And so if you would do that, that would be a tremendous blessing. But then pray. In a moment, we'll have prayer, and we'll call upon Brother Alex to remember, especially as you pray, as we give, that you'll pray for the friend day, that the Lord would be in it, that unsaved people would come, and that God's power would be present to save them. And then today there is a ladies' Bible study at 2 o'clock. That is today, this afternoon, our evening service at 5, followed by our men's meeting. And of course, be praying as we're preaching the gospel all month long, and also street preaching on Tuesday evenings at 6:30. And so pray as we're preaching and proclaiming the gospel as far and as wide as we possibly can here at Cornerstone Baptist Church. Academy Chapel, Thursday at 8:35. Saturday, men's and women's prayer meeting at 9 o'clock. Bus and soul winning at 9:30. There is a tug of war tournament taking place after this service is over. And so those of you that are a part of that, make sure you're in your places ready to tug, okay? Ready to tug. All right, if you have a cell phone, I'm going to ask that you power that off at this time. And then we ask that once the preaching of the Bible begins, that we not have people getting up and walking out in and out of the preaching time. And that is because we don't want the distraction when we're preaching God's word, especially preaching the gospel. And so once the preaching begins, we ask that you help us with that. No getting up and walking around during the service. Also, the overflow seating is not open seating for the church services. There's plenty of room here in the auditorium, and we want those who want to be under the sound of the word of God to be in this room joining the rest of us. We also want to ask the children to remember their cleaning jobs throughout the afternoon, and not to forget those. This coming Friday is the first youth rally, and that will be held at 6 o'clock. There'll be food there at, the name of the church just escaped my mind, but I remember the pastor's name, Pastor Nutter. His church is out in Crete, First Baptist Church of Crete, Illinois. And the rally will be starting at 6 o'clock. And the Bible quiz, of course, will be a part of the service at 7. The preaching competition is in November, and so I wanted to announce that in case we have any young men that want to compete in the preaching competition. You have several months to prepare. As the ushers make their way forward, be praying ahead of time for October, our marriage month, that the messages will be timely and that they will meet the need of the hour concerning the marriages at Cornerstone Baptist Church. Alex, if you would come and especially pray for Friend Day. And there are invitations. Let me mention that as well. There are invitations in the annex hallway for Friend Day. There's a digital copy as well that you can send out. But nobody come alone next Sunday. Find somebody, especially somebody that needs to be saved, and bring them out to Friend Day. Brother Alex, if you...
All Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father God, we, Lord, are just, Lord, so blessed to be able to be in your house this morning, Lord. It's safe. You've given us all to travel, God, and the ability to wake up and Lord, the ability to move and be here in your house, Lord. I pray, Father, that you would meet with us, God, today. You'd speak to our hearts, God. Be with Pastor, God. And God, use him. Use him mightily, God, to bring forth your word, God. And Lord God, I know just looking out, Lord, in the crowd of people, God, seeing new faces, God, seeing old faces, God, and seeing hearts, Lord, that might not know you, God. Give us compassion, Lord, upon them. And God, the reason they're here, God, is we're not for fun, God. Although it's okay to have fun, God, but not that's not the main reason they're here. God, the reason they're here, Lord, is so that they could hear the gospel, and God, so that they could be saved. Oh, God, save their souls and help us, God, as members of the church, God, to have compassion with them and, Lord, deal with them, God, according to the Bible, God. Lord, we ask, Father, that as your word goes forth, God, you would just convict their hearts, God, help them to see their need for you, God. And Lord, we think of a friend day coming up, and God, Pastor Carl Lubin, God, that you would be with him, Lord, and be with the message he's bringing forth, God. And Lord, help us, Lord, to bring friends out, Lord, family out, God. Whoever we know, God, help us to bring them out, Lord. Help us to, Lord, go out, Lord, looking for lost souls to bring in, God, that they might hear the gospel and be saved, Father. We pray for our marriage month, God. Oh, God, the sanctity of marriage, Father, and that you would help those of us who are married, God, and even those of us who are not, God, to be looking, Lord, for you to speak to our hearts, God. And Lord, that we might, Lord, have a marriage that is honorable before you. Oh, God, I pray, Father, that as we take up this offering, God, that we would give, Father, we'd give with joyful hearts. Lord, we'd be glad that we can give. Oh, God, that we can give back to you. God, it's a privilege. God, help us to give with joy, not begrudging. Lord, you've given us so much. You died. Lord, you died on Calvary. You died for us. You shed your blood, God. Lord, I pray, Father, again, even just looking at the bus kids that came in today, God, that you would speak to their heart. God, help them to listen. God, you did something wonderful for them 2,000 years ago, Lord, and I just think about what you did for me. And God, you saved my wretched soul. And God, you want to do something with their lives, God. It's unimaginable that they could never fathom, God. So, God, I pray that they would listen, God, and I pray that this day, Lord, would honor you, Holy Spirit, that you would meet with us. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Stand with me one last time. 52 will be the hymn. To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son. As was just prayed, that's the greatest thing someone can ever do for you. And that's give his life that you may have eternal life with God someday. So let's sing about it. Let's revel in it. And let's rejoice in it. 52, to God be the glory. Happy that to God be the glory. 52. Thank you. as we make our way back to Assisi, the last verse in 52, to God be the glory, verse number 3. We're going to sing it out like we mean it this morning. 52, to God be the glory. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory. Great things he has done.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Be thou exalted forever. Please take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. The title of the message this morning is, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. This is not our text passage. We'll look at a couple of passages before we come to our text. And then when we come to our text, I'll ask that you'll stand for the reading of it, but not just yet. Okay, John chapter 1. Need my ushers to pay particular attention to the young people. Make sure they are focused in like a laser. John chapter 1. I do believe it's important that you take the Bible in your hand, turn to these passages, look on with someone with the Bible if you do not. Those of you with Bibles, if you would look for someone maybe close to you that doesn't have a copy of the scriptures. We do have pew Bibles, but I'm a firm believer that you need to see it in the Word of God yourself if you're going to get anything from it. And so John chapter 1, beginning in verse number 6. John chapter 1, verse number 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. You'll notice that light in that passage is capitalized because it's referring to a person. Go with me to John chapter 9. John chapter 9. If you're in adult Sunday school, which if you are an adult where you should be on Sunday mornings, you'll know that this passage is where we are studying right now. John chapter 9. Jesus is answering for why he is going to heal the man that was born blind. John chapter 9, look with me at verse number 5. Jesus said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And then go with me to our text, which is John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Jesus is not only the door, he is also at the same time the light of the world. John chapter 8, the context is Jesus is, and you should want to know the context, so you should be listening very closely right now. The context is Jesus is teaching and preaching in the temple, and there was a woman that was caught in the act of adultery brought to him, and Jesus made that profound statement to the Pharisees, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. He is forgiving her of her sins. She is a forgiven woman. He tells her to go and sin no more. And then he starts right at our text verse in John chapter 8. Verse number 12, I'm going to ask that you'll stand for the reading of the text out of respect for the Word of God. John chapter 8, verse number 12. John 8, 12. Scripture. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. In that one verse, I see five things that I want to give you today before you leave. First of all, the word of Jesus demands a hearing. Secondly, the radiance of Jesus demands a looking. Third, the expanse of Jesus demands your wonder. Fourth, the person of Jesus demands a following. And then last, the promise of Jesus demands your claiming. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for that light. I thank you that it has shone upon my sinful heart. And I thank you that that light is still shining. Lord, I pray that you'll use your word today to convince the hearers that Jesus is the light of the world. I pray this in your son's precious name. Amen. You may be seated. And then look this way quietly. The word of Jesus demands a hearing. Don't you dare divorce Jesus from his words. Verse number 12, and you check me out, begins this way. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, Jesus is about to speak. Jesus is about to use words. Always get on the edge of your seat and listen intently when Jesus is about to speak. The weight and the wisdom of his words melt the heart of stone, making people to know that Jesus is the light of the world. Think of his radiant eyes, his pity upon the poor people that he encountered in his earthly ministry. How that his eyes shone like the sun of righteousness with healing in his wings. Think of him as the healer of diseases, coming to that leper. Leprosy, a nasty, ugly, oozing skin disease in biblical times. And him coming to that leper and saying, be thou clean. Did the world welcome him as he loudly proclaimed, I am the light of the world? He flashed that light into their eyes and blinded them with his brilliance, because Jesus is the light of the world. As the light of the world, he can light up the deep recesses of your heart right now as I'm preaching. His beams can shine into your heart as I utter words and convince you that Jesus is the light of the world. The words of Jesus are powerful words. His voice is the voice of the Lord. How is that voice heard today? Through the preaching of the Bible, through the reading of the Bible. You can hear the voice of the Lord. If you're under the sound of his voice, friend, he has not given up on you. If you're still, watch me now, sitting in a pew in a Bible-believing church, hearing the words of Jesus, you are not outside of your opportunity to be saved, because Jesus is the light of the world. Oh, hear his voice. I'm asking you. It's where the text starts. Jesus started talking and saying some words to them. Start right there. If you're holding the word of Jesus, consider it. If you're looking on your neighbor's shoulder, looking at the words of Jesus, consider it. They will proclaim louder than I could that Jesus is the light of the world. Secondly, the radiance of Jesus demands a looking. The radiance of Jesus demands a looking. Look at the text with me if you would. John chapter 8, verse number 12. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light. I am the light. Who could say that? Joshua never said that. Moses never tried to say that. David never uttered those words. Jesus said, I am the light. From his cradle to the resurrection, Christ is the light of the world. When he came into this world, it was a light in the form of a star in Bethlehem that announced his coming to the earth. He was called a light to lighten the Gentiles. As a preacher, he was the light. His preaching shed light on the Old Testament. His parables pour light on the doctrine of salvation and the kingdom of heaven. His death was in darkness. The Bible says that darkness came upon the earth when Jesus died. But I want to say that's when he shone brightest, on the cross of Calvary. He is that lighthouse right now. And the rays of that lighthouse shine forth over the dark waters of your life and can lead you safely through the rocks, pull you into the harbor of himself, convincing you that Jesus is the light of the world. We're talking about Jesus, precious. We're talking about God in human flesh. We're talking about a lamb for sinners slain who said, "I am the light of the world." Almost weekly, I hear people say to me, "Pastor Lewis, I'm in a dark place." My friend, if you're here right now and you're in a dark place, I don't know how you got there, but I am 100% sure how you can get out of a dark place. And that is Jesus, who said, "I am the light of the world." The darkness in your life can vanish because of the rays of the Son of God. The dark tomb. Let's visit there for just a moment. For 3 days, that tomb was dark. For 3 days, that tomb was gloom. But watch the glorious light of his resurrection. Think of the heavenly representative, the Holy Ghost, that Jesus left on this earth to testify of him until he comes again. As the light of the world, I'm going to make a bold statement. And before you count me as a heretic, hear me out. The light of Jesus shines brighter today than it did when he was on earth 2,000 years ago. 2,000 years ago, he only had 12 reflectors called apostles to shine forth his brilliance. But today, the names of those that know Christ are in the millions. And they all reflect the same message, that Jesus is the light of the world. Thousands of hearts are ablaze right now. Thousands of hearts could stand at this pulpit and tell you more eloquently than I ever could that Jesus is the light of the world. From his cradle to his tomb, to his ascension up into heaven, to his sure return back to this same earth, Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the true light. Now, there are some other lights, but Jesus is the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. I don't know how many of you have studied the religion of the Jews, but in the Old Testament, it speaks of that great golden candlestick, the menorah. And the Jews still look to that as a symbol of light. But in reality, that candlestick was a symbol of the Lord Jesus Christ, a type of the light of Jesus. And people look to religion for light and they find none, because Jesus is the light of the world. The flickering candle of philosophy will yield no light. The philosophies of man, it's not even worth your research. Aristotle is not worth much of your time. Their knowledge is not worth you knowing. But Christ extinguishes all of the flickering candles of religion and philosophy as he proclaims, "I am the light of the world." I'm talking about the flickering candles of the Buddhist, the Muslim, the Taoist, the Roman Catholic, the Jehovah's Witness, the Mormon, the Hindu, the New Age, they are all struck matches that are soon to be blown out. And Jesus will continue as the light of the world. The sparks of astrology yield no light. I don't want to know your sign, because it's just a flickering candle that gives no real light. Well, I'm a this, I'm a that, because I was born in this month. No, those are lightning bugs of superstition. Jesus is the light of the world. And those lights, those false lights, sadly, but truthfully, extinguish one another. They contradict one another, they extinguish one another, but Jesus keeps shining brightly. Because Jesus is the light of the world. Some people are dazed by the light of public opinion. They get on Google to find out what this person thinks about this or what that person thinks about that. They're dazed by the light of public opinion. I can tell you a much better and brighter light than public opinion, and that is Jesus, who is the light of the world. In Chicago, people are bamboozled by the dingy light of immorality and adultery and fornication and homosexuality and transgenderism. There's no light there, but we have a trustworthy and a true when we hear him proclaim, "I am the light of the world." Where can you go to find light? I can tell you where you can go to find light. In the birth, in the ministry, in the death, and in the resurrection of the Christ of Nazareth, who said, "I am the light of the world." Third, the expanse of Jesus demands our wonder. The expanse of Jesus demands our wonder. Look with me at the text, verse number 12, where the Bible says, "Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light," don't miss this, "of the world." Of the world. Jesus is the universal light. He says, "I am the light of the world." He doesn't say, "I'm the light of the Jews." He didn't say, "I'm the light of the black Israelites on the street corner." He doesn't say, "I'm the light of the Gentiles." He doesn't say, "I'm the light of the black, the light of the white, the light of the yellow." He says, "I am the light of this world." And there is nothing on this globe that pertains to truth concerning God that can be explained apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, because he is the light of the world. When we were flying to Israel, my wife may remember this, but when we were flying to Israel, there were some Muslim men, three young men, I think, that were sitting in a row, and for the entire flight, they were reading the Quran. The entire flight. And they would doze off and sleep, and they would wake up again, and they had it in front of them, and they had the audio and the words, and they were reading the Quran. I have read portions of the Quran, and if there's any light in the Quran, it is light borrowed from the Old and New Testament. It is borrowed light. The light of Confucianism and Zoroastrianism is borrowed from the Old Testament and the New Testament, because light only has one source, and people can borrow the light, but they can never replace the light. Jesus is the light of the world. And any real light comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. And as you trace the trail of light, it will always lead you to Jesus Christ. It'll always bring you right back to him. It's like the crumbs from the old nursery rhyme, leading you along. He sheds his beams over the whole earth. And I want you to know that there's coming a day when every knee will bow to the light of the world, which is Jesus. The crescent of Muhammad will fade into obscurity, and the light of the world will still shine. So I want you that know the Lord to stop being down today. I want you that know the name of the Lord to stop having a defeatist attitude, like I'm just trying to hang on, it's so bad. No, listen, the gospel will still triumph, souls can still be saved, churches can still be built, bus routes can still be blessed. Have courage, have zest. We're not on the losing side. Jesus is the light of the world. This battle will be won by our captain, who says, you just keep flinging the artillery of my word at those enemies. And when you get weak, and as we all do, we get weak. When you get weak, I will raise up other believers to join the ranks and to join the reserves so that you can get back on that battling field and continue to fight alongside of the captain of your salvation, who is the light of the world. Fourth, the following. The person of Jesus demands a following. The person of Jesus demands a following. Please look again at our text. Verse number 12, do look at the Bible. John chapter 8, verse number 12. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me, he that followeth me. You cannot have this light by hearing about it. You cannot have this light by reading about it. You cannot have this light because your cousin has that light or because a grandparent had that light. No, there must be a coming after Jesus in your heart. Jesus said, he that followeth me, quit following your thoughts. And this is good for saved folk too. You say, I've got some good thoughts. You better check it against the word of God. And that'll tell you if it's a good thought. But don't follow your thoughts. Jesus said, he that followeth me. Your emotions will lead you to destruction. Both you and your family. Would you stop following your emotions? Jesus said, he that followeth me. Stop following your stupid feelings. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Stop following your feelings. Jesus said, he that followeth me. Quit following your family. Now, it's fine to follow with your family if they're following Christ. But if they're not, then like the blind man who was blind from birth, follow Jesus even when your family won't. Jesus said, he that followeth me. Stop following tradition. People will get on Facebook and make all of these friends, and you make friends, so instantly you're following them, and you're following them closer in some cases than you're following the Lord Jesus Christ. Look this way. Who are you following? The person of Jesus demands a following. To follow him means to commit your soul to him. It means to commit yourself to him, to believe on him, to say, I have no other master. He is going to be the guiding light of my soul. And you follow him. Jesus said, he that followeth me. He that followeth me. Now, if you want good fundamental Baptist brethren to be your companions on the road, then praise God. But follow him. You follow him till you reach the gates of glory. Fifth. And last, the promise of Jesus demands a claiming. The promise of Jesus demands a claiming. Look this way. He makes a promise. Are you going to claim it? Or leave it on the table? Look at verse number 12. I want you to see the promise. Do look at the Bible, verse number 12, our text. Then spake Jesus again unto them. Look at the Bible, young people. Do you have a Bible to look at? No? No Bible? Precious said, no Bible. Somebody look on the Bible with her. Here we go. Look at verse number 12. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me, here's the promise, It demands a claiming. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. What if somehow you had some type of supernatural powers that could allow you to travel so fast through the time zones that you could always be on a place on this globe where it's daytime? And you could go your whole life and never see darkness. None of us have that ability. But Jesus says that if you follow the Son of God, the Bible says you'll never walk in darkness. And it's talking about spiritual darkness. He is the guiding light. Hey, if you're going through sickness, struggle, financial burden, despair, He is the guiding light. Trust Him. And when you come to die, as we all must, and you're ready to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you don't need to fear evil if you have Christ, because He is the light of the world. There's an old hymn that says this: Son of my soul, S-U-N, Son of my soul, thou Savior dear, it is not night if thou be near. Blessed is the man that commits his soul to Jesus, because Jesus said, you will never walk in darkness. There's a whole lot of people in Chicago right now that are walking in darkness, and they don't have to. Now, I want to wind down by asking a personal question. And that question is this: since Christ is the light of the world, how do you look under that light? As He shines that light on your soul, what does He see? Saved or lost? As He puts that light onto the recesses of your heart, is it heaven or hell? I found that people in darkness don't readily want to be under the light. There were people that promised me yesterday that they were going to be in church, and they're not here. People many times don't want to be under the light. If they have a Bible, they don't read it. If there's a gospel preaching church, they won't attend it. They don't want the light. If the pastor wants to talk to them, they don't have time. It's just like, and I'm sorry, I grew up in the projects. I grew up in Henry Horner Homes on Lake and Damon, and when we come home from church late at night or wherever we were and turn on the light, the roaches were everywhere and they were running from the light. And that reminds me of people today. You see, too much light exposes the fact that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Too much light from the Bible shines the fact that there is none righteous. No, not one. You're all sinners, and so am I. If you are afraid of light, be very suspicious of yourself right now. If Brandon Johnson, our mayor, put up a vote on who all in the city of Chicago wants the street lights to be turned off at 9 o'clock, there's a certain type of person that would vote for that and would want that. The Bible says in John 3:20, for everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. Now listen, you came into this world in darkness. You know what it was when you were in your mother's womb? Darkness. And you will exit this world through the valley of the shadow of death. It'll be a little dark. And in between the time of your birth and your death is a golden opportunity to come to Jesus, the light of the world. If you don't take that opportunity, you're going to die and you're going to burn in hell. You're going to burn in hell for all of eternity because you chose not to come to the light. Nothing will be hid from the light of His judgment. Don't you shrug your shoulders and curl your lip. There is coming a day when the hearts of men will be made manifest before His throne, and every hidden thing shall be made known. Repent and come to the light before you die, For your soul is cast into the lake of fire where there is eternal darkness. You know what there is in hell? There's fire and there's darkness. You say, how can there be fire and darkness? The Bible says so. That's how. Fire and darkness. But he is the light of the world. The Bible says nowhere that he's the light of hell. If you're going there, you're going to a place where there is no light. And you'll burn for eternity. I think of robbers and thieves that are caught sometimes on surveillance cameras breaking the security cameras. And instead of repenting of their evil and changing their ways, they try to tear down the light. They try to break down the light so that it's not revealing them for what they are. And that's people in church too. They come to church and they don't want to repent, so they want to point fingers and break down the light. My friend, don't do that. We sang a hymn today, and the hymn said, come to the light, 'tis shining for thee. Sweetly the light has dawned upon thee. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. If you've not yet come to that light, I'm going to invite you to do so today. In fact, when the piano starts to play, I'm going to stand down there. And for 15 years, we've had people slip out of their pews and come down and say, I need to be saved. I need to come to the light today. And if that's you, I'll meet you here at the front. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you do a work in hearts and bring the lost to the light? I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand to your feet with your heads bowed. Heads bowed and eyes closed. The service isn't over. In fact, this is one of the most important parts of the service. So please don't pack up. Don't treat it lightly. We're still in church. And with heads bowed and eyes closed, I just ask you, did I preach that message today for you? Was that message preached because he's calling you right now to come to the light? The light shining. What's at stake is heaven and hell. And Jesus is saying, come to the light. If you've already come to the light, then Jesus says to you, ye are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. Shine brightly and reflect the light of the world, Jesus. But when that instrument plays, I'm calling on those who have not yet come to the light and say, it's not worth going to hell for. I want to come to the light today because I don't know how long I have. April 22nd, 1993, as a 13-year-old boy, I came to the light. And I have never regretted. As the piano plays, if that message was particularly for you, then you come meet me here at the front.
Thank you for